Welcome back to Sun Devil Stadium. The Cowboys leading 30-0, having just kicked a field goal, of course. They weren't still driving when I handed back to the action. It's the Steelers' ball then. They desperately need some points on the board before half-time, and they have the ball at their own 32.
This Buds really did it well. I thought so. First down, Pittsburgh at the 32-yard line. Protection throw down it, over the middle, incomplete. Thrown behind Yancey Thigpen. Thigpen, the leading receiver for the Steelers this year, set a record for a season with 85 catches. That went a little behind him.
Well, we've set up here, and of course we have a good view, but one thing we've said already, Neil O'Donnell is getting a little time, and the receivers are open down the field. Right there, nobody is really around Yancey Thigpen, but Neil O'Donnell throws it just a little bit too far behind him.
Two tight ends, Jonathan Hayes and Mark Bruner, bookend. Bruner in motion.
Forrest the ball carrier.
That one was in trouble from the handoff. O'Donnell barely got out of the way.
I mean, you go first down, you throw, and you don't get anything. And then you run that play with two tight ends, so they're waiting on run, and you don't get anything. I mean, this offense has got to take some slack from the defense and give these guys a rest.
Steelers have scored in the second quarter all season long. It's been a good period for them, including the playoffs. They've not been shut out in the second quarter, and we have only 5 minutes plus remaining today. And a third and 11. Blitz. O'Donnell, incomplete, through the hands of Andre Hastings.
Guess who's covering downfield? The guy we haven't mentioned all day long, Leon Lett. They have a blitz. Leon Lett is the tackle, probably the biggest defensive lineman they have, and he's downfield making some coverage.
Well, Paul, look what happens. Here's Leon Lett. He's going to drop back. Watch the blitz from the top. Looking for something to Neil O'Donnell's right. He gets back there. Not a factor, but they still got pressure on Neil O'Donnell.
Now, three and out for the Steelers, and Ron Stark to kick off the side of his foot. Deion Sanders lets it bounce. A good Pittsburgh roll, and covered by Leaf and Flowers. And the Cowboys touch the ball. Let's see if the Steelers are rolled the possession. It appeared to touch a Cowboy leg.
Dick, it does. But I'm going to tell you what happens. They knock the player into the ball.
And it is Dallas's ball. They roll Cowboys' ball. It was touched, but apparently on a push by a Steeler.
Coming downfield. Now watch number 23. He's going to get knocked from behind. They don't see if it hits him or not. Gilden is the guy that hit him, number 92. Watch this. Does he hit? Does he get hit? Here's Gilden. That's Bell hitting. 40.
And Dallas retains possession. We have a timeout.
Well, shades of Leon Lett against Miami a couple of years ago there. It looked like the Dallas player had touched the ball and given it to Pittsburgh, but you think the officials were right, Marv?
Well, you do not stand around the ball that's there, really. You teach your players to get away from it. Robert Bailey stayed close to that ball. A Pittsburgh player wisely here tries to knock him into the ball. And if that was Myron Bell, and if the ball did touch the Dallas player, Pittsburgh would have had it right there deep in Dallas territory.
And of course, what brought the play about was another Pittsburgh punt, and they desperately need to get some offense going soon, don't they?
They need to get it going badly, and they're not being able to. They can't run the ball, and they're straining the clip in their passing game.
Are you surprised at how tough Dallas are playing the Steelers in the middle of the defense? Because if you look at their three defeats this season, apart from the San Francisco one, the two by Washington, the one by the Eagles, those teams won really by running the ball up the middle on Dallas.
Yeah, you know, I think the key for the defense right now for the Cowboys is the control in the defensive line. They are controlling the Steelers' offensive line. They can't get that running game going. And then when they try to throw the football, they're putting a lot of pressure on Neil O'Donnell. So they're dominating the trenches here, and I think the Steelers are a little confused. They don't know if they want to run the football or pass the football in this situation so far.
Well, you've come across Ron Ehart, the Steelers' offensive coordinator, of course, in Super Bowl XXX when he was with the Giants. What adjustments do you think that he might make to get something going?
Well, they had a different style of offense. In fact, they had a style of offense which the Steelers had used last season and early this year. What they have to do is begin to make plays. Yancey Thigpen had a tough catch. He's caught 85 this year. He needs to make that kind of play along the way.
And as Drew said, Neil O'Donnell hasn't really settled down, hasn't been given a chance to settle down.
He needs a chance to settle down. Right now, he is pressing. Very definitely, Gary.
All right, and the Cowboys are back in possession. Let's go back to the game now.
Unintentionally touched that ball. He was blocked into it and rules state that then the receiving team does maintain possession. And so it is from the 14 after the 55-yard punt by Starr. Aikman with plenty of time, under 5 minutes remaining in this first half. Incomplete on Darryl Johnston. Let's go back to the punt.
Right here, you're going to see, right here's Robert Bailey. And watch Myron Bell come up and hit him in the back.
But it looked
like,
call.
Yeah, it looks like he touches the ball, but I don't know. He might have, the back of his legs, might have touched that football right there, but it would not matter. It still would go to the receiving team.
I mean, Aikman again, look at this field. It's supposed to be so tight, and here's Aikman slipping down again. It's unbelievable, this field. We thought it was a lot better.
That ends a string of 10 straight completions for Aikman. He's dropped for a loss in the backfield. Greg Lloyd announces his presence.
Emmett's still down, and Emmett Smith is hurt. Lloyd hit him in while he's up limping. Here comes Lloyd down. And watch this. You talk about sacrifice your body. He goes underneath the block and gets Emmett.
Something I've noticed already. Greg Lloyd, when these big linemen are pulling out now, he is deciding to take his side. So that way he won't have to take them on because he cannot win that battle.
Very smart.
Good smart, that's right.
Third and a long 10. Deion Sanders to the left, three receivers to the right. Novacek has been the man in this situation. Aikman over the middle, incomplete, knocked down by Chris Oldham. And Reuben was breaking in the clear, had Oldham not gotten the left paw in the way.
Boy, you know, they're showing an awful lot of confidence in Rod Woodson. They're lining him up on Deion Sanders and letting him play one and one, so they have the confidence. Here it comes.
What's an excellent job. Look at Troy Aikman right there. Really never sees Chris Oldham. If that ball would have been down, Chris Oldham would have picked that off and probably scored a touchdown.
Right hand knocks it away, and for the first time, the Cowboys three and out. Andre Hastings at the 42 of Pittsburgh. First punt for John Jett. And he sends up beauty. Perfect spiral. Hastings at the 35. Gets two blocks, three. Runs into his own man. And down he goes near the 50-yard line. Willie Williams actually made the hit on Andre Hastings.
Well, he was blocking Dale Hellestray, number 70 for Dallas, and they ran into each other.
No flags on the return, and Pittsburgh. Well, it's. We'll start from the 46-yard line.
Dick, they got to light it up. They've got to do something now, Phil. One of those special plays that they have in that jar that he says we're going to empty it, they better start emptying the jar now.
3 minutes, 52 seconds remain in the opening half. 13-0 Dallas.
Good play call right there by the Pittsburgh Steelers and Ron Earhart, the offensive coordinator. Neil O'Donnell, the receiver's wide open. He's a little too careful with the football. Threw it outside. The receiver's not able to make the adjustment.
I mean, he talked about open. That was an 8-yard completion and would have ended up close to a first down, if not get it.
O'Donnell, who played at Maryland, recruited there by Bobby Ross. The Charger coach is 4-for-10 in this opening half.
Texan breaks down, and Charles Haley has his first sack today.
Let me just say one thing before you describe all this stuff, Phil. The reason this sack comes is because of the great coverage downfield. This is the coverage sack. So Haley gets credit for it, but look what happens here. There's a lot of time back in the backfield.
Well, John Jackson right there really had him in good position. John Jackson did not expect Neil O'Donnell to be so deep in your right paw. The coverage downfield was excellent. Neil O'Donnell retreats a little right into the hands of Charles Haley.
Haley shooting for his fifth Super Bowl ring. Two of the 49ers, two of the Cowboys. His parents seeing their first Super Bowl game from Glass, Virginia. Third and 20 for O'Donnell. Underneath he goes to Hastings with some running room. And Hastings fights close to a first down.
is at the 44. It appears he's just shy.
It's four down territory. You've got 3 minutes to go. You've got to score. You've got to at least get on the board. They've got about a half a yard for a first down. You have to get inside the 44-yard line. They are not inside. It's going to be short about a half a yard, and that's about it.
Well, you talk about run after the catch, Phil Simms. Hastings was really determined to get to the sticks.
He was, Dick, and that was a good job by Neil O'Donnell. Stay in patience. Andre Hastings was actually in the backfield that time, released underneath and just caught that ball running full speed.
Half yard. Third down. Fourth down.
Fourth and inches. Here's Hastings' effort.
Well, Andre Hastings is going to make sure that they do blitz. He's going to be in the backfield to catch. But look at him right here. Watch him sneak through there. Cowboys are thinking it's going to be down the field. He catches that ball, and he is full speed right there. Here's Deion Sanders coming up trying to make the tackle.
Hey, Mike, get down. Are you watching?
That'll take a little luster off the neon.
Yeah, that will.
I wonder if Ditka was watching that play.
This is the second fourth down where Pittsburgh has gone for it. They used Cordell Stewart on a sneak for a first down, and he's under center again.
Go right, Cordell, go right.
He does. First down, Pittsburgh.
Well, the whole big opening is on the right-hand side.
Cordell Stewart, he has brought so much to this Pittsburgh team. That's why the nickname slash quarterback slash receiver. And in this computer age, you can punch up some pretty impressive numbers for slash. As a quarterback, he's 5 for 7. As a running back, average 5.7 and 14 catches. And he's even punted once for 41 yards. O'Donnell going long for fake pass. Incomplete.
Now, I'll tell you what, here's where you can have some offensive pass interference on Thigpen. And that's what Deion is talking about. Thigpen this time was pushing off on the way down the field.
I tell you what, Paul, if you want to throw the football down the field on Deion Sanders and these type of routes, watch here. Yancey Thigpen's going to release outside. Deion has him pinned to the sideline. The only chance you have is to throw it behind the receiver where he can stop and catch on the outside shoulder.
I still think the only place to go for Deion Sanders, too, is if you're going to throw, you go inside.
Absolutely.
You throw inside of him. Don't go outside or down the field.
First time they've tested Sanders in this half. Second and 10, Van Horns.
Big man rumbles. First down at the 30 with 2:06. And ticking away, we come to the two-minute timeout. Pittsburgh's best chance to score, and the Steelers' terrible towels are out.
For some, the price of progress is a cluttered, more crowded world. Orange have a clear view of the future. Our digital network has been designed to grow with the needs of our users. So, however busy we get, there will always be room for you. The future's bright. The future's Orange. Call 0800 80 10 80.
You see, some clients are completely and utterly obstinate. They always think they know better than you.
Clerical Medical understand what it means to be a professional. That's why, since 1824, so many have come to us for pensions, investments, and life assurance. Clerical Medical, the choice of the professional.
The Citroën ZX handles superbly due to its programmed rear-wheel steering system. So how well does it take bends? Allow me to demonstrate.
Well, it's no fun if it's too easy.
Welcome back to Sun Devil Stadium. The Steelers haven't scored all half, but they're threatening. They've got the ball at the 35 after that huge run by Bam Morris, and they finally got some momentum going on offense. Let's go to the network now and see where they can capitalize on this possession.
And outstanding the final 2 minutes of the first half. In fact, in the second quarter, last 2 minutes, they've scored 9 of their last 11 games. Bodes well for Pittsburgh. First down at the Dallas 30, trailing 13-0. They're trying to find a hole off that right side. Looked like he had some running room, but Darren Smith closed the hole. Second down and 7. And a timeout call. No, there's no timeout.
No timeout. What the Steelers right here, of course you want to try to score, but also do not give the Cowboys time left on the clock where they get one more opportunity.
Tight end runner in motion. Looks that throw's right. Incomplete. Jonathan Hayes never had control. Covered by Dixon Edwards.
Jonathan Hayes, you got to turn your hands around the other way, Jonathan. Jonathan had his hands upside down. Watch when he throws his ball to the outside. Look at Jonathan Hayes' hands. They're down. Turn around like that. Get your hands back to the ball. Make the turn. Make the catch of the football first before you run. This is not four down territory either. It'll be a field goal if they don't make this first down.
O'Donnell has hit on only one of his last 7 throws. 3rd and 7. They go to the 5 wide with John L. Williams in the backfield. O'Donnell, quick throw, complete, but short of the first down. Ernie Mills hit right at the 20-yard line, did not penetrate, which would be required for the first down. So it's going to be inches short. Oh, what a mark.
They're getting a great mark.
Oh, man. They mark it on the 20. First down, Pittsburgh.
Now, wait a minute. It's got to be where the ball ends up. Now, this has got to be one of the greatest marks I've ever seen. Yeah, you're right. I think you're right, Barry. This baby has got to be just inside the 20 on the black line. That angle there, look where he comes down. He's hit here. He's knocked way back.
It's not where he comes in down, Paul. It's where he catches it up in the air. Right here, you can see.
He's not behind the line. He's behind the line.
It's pretty close.
Pretty close.
But a generous spot, nevertheless. You don't usually get that kind of forward progress on that play.
I'm going to tell you guys now, for the last game this year, don't you go questioning my eyes now.
Yeah.
Not now.
Yeah. Well, it's a first down for the Steelers with a timeout and 1:05 left in this first half. And it's very apparent, even for those who don't watch a lot of football and come around at Super Bowl time, that with the recent records of the NFC domination over the AFC and the Cowboys scoring on their first 3 possessions, and it looked as if at times they might run away, that a Steeler touchdown here could make this an interesting Sunday. But if they are failed to score, then perhaps we're off to another disappointing Super Bowl experience. That is the encouraging statistic for Steeler fans. First down and 10.
Charles Haley almost went into Pittsburgh huddle to say something to John Jackson. I don't know what he said, but he's lined up on him.
Cordell slotted left. Short in motion.
O'Donnell is sacked by Chad Hennings.
Hennings, a 2-time GTE Academic All-America from the Air Force Academy, the 288-pound former pilot in the Persian Gulf crisis.
There was a little confusion, I think, inside. Right, well, Chad Hennings, all he does is just throw Tom Newberry to the side and get straight to the quarterback. Neil O'Donnell's got to be ready. Short drop. If it breaks free, the defensive lineman, throw it away.
Joe Palooka type from Elberton, Iowa. Population 150. Second down. Underneath the Hastings. Tackled immediately. Good coverage from Robert Bailey, a former Ram.
Well, what you do here, the first thing you want to make sure, give yourself a chance to kick this field goal.
Now the Steelers will use a timeout here with a ball just outside the 23-yard line. Not only is NBC producing worldwide coverage of the Super Bowl today, we're also producing coverage of the worldwide
Marv, 3rd and 14 here inside the last 30 seconds of the game. What do you call?
you've got to go downfield deep, no question about that. They're in tough situation. The odds are heavily with Dallas right here. They hope to come away with a field goal right now.
And Drew, this could be a big turning point either way in the game, as far as momentum's concerned.
That's right. Well, the Steelers drove it down pretty good. What they want to do is get something out of this, but they got 20 seconds in a third down situation. They have to take a shot in the end zone, and if they don't complete the pass, come back and kick the field goal. But the worst thing that could happen for the Steelers right now is to not get anything out of this sustained drive.
And from the smile on your face, I can see that's what you'd like. All right, let's see what they're actually going to do. Here it is, third down for the Steelers.
Phil, you've been watching five wide. In this five wide set so far, who is usually open? Everybody? Somebody?
Well, somebody has been open every play, and it's usually inside. So here we have the five wide receiver set
with the Stewart, the nearest receiver on the right side. O'Donnell has to hurry to the end zone. No, short but caught. What a catch by Ernie Mills. Mills, who made the brilliant reception at the end of the AFC Championship game against the Colts. And the Steelers spend their final timeout. A 17-yard play, and what a catch by this young man who played with Emmitt Smith at the University of Florida.
And you're right, you said someone's going to be wide open, and he was wide open.
There's Ernie Mills going to come across. Watch the clear out right here. Inside is where people have been coming open most of the day. Ernie Mills cuts inside. What a catch going up high. No one he was going to get hit when the ball was delivered to him.
Scott Case, the defender.
Oh, he gets nailed by Scott Case, but watch this catch. That ball is bobbled in the air, and he still has enough to hold on to the football. They pick up the first down. The only problem is they're running out of time. They only have 17 seconds, and they have no more timeouts.
Ball at the 6-yard line. Well, with a pass, you're two passes into the end zone, and if you don't make it, the field goal.
I think right here, Dick, quick passes, you have three. But the thing about it is, Phil, is you've got to make sure that guy you're throwing to is not in a crowd. You've got to throw that baby, I would think, to the outside more so than the inside.
They stay with the five wide.
Job of standing in there, having a little patience, and really throwing the ball in the only spot it could have been for the completion and the touchdown.
Norm Johnson adds the extra point, 13-7 Dallas.
One thing about it, I said earlier, and I think everybody knows that, if you're going to beat Deion Sanders, you beat him to the inside. You don't try to beat him outside or deep. This is where Neil O'Donnell threw this ball.
That's right. Here, look up top. Here's Yancey Thigpen going to run inside. Watch Deion Sanders. He's hoping for some help in the inside, but Neil O'Donnell just throws it before the help can get there.
I mean, it's just a perfect throw. You depend on a guy on the outside, and Neil O'Donnell knows that. And you got to know that you can throw the ball inside on Deion Sanders. That time, Thigpen went in. Sanders couldn't stay with him, and here it is. Watch how quick this ball is delivered inside. Even Deion is sitting inside, and he beats him.
Thigpen's first catch of this Super Bowl, a 6-yard touchdown to culminate the 54-yard Steeler drive.
Watch Deion Sanders right here. He's playing it to go outside. He wants help inside. Actually pushes the receiver before he catches it.
You know what I don't understand? I don't understand why pass interference wasn't called.
Kay Cower, a star basketball player at North Carolina State, played professional basketball. Megan at 9 knows more about football than most people that sit next to in a stadium. And Bill Cower's team has scratched back 13-7.
Well, you know, that was amazing. I mean, Deion Sanders pushes Thigpen on the way down. Again, that is normal speed. That's not slow motion. But he's pushing him. That should have been called pass interference right from the beginning.
13 seconds left in the half, and Johnson will skid one into the wedge. Might have taken by Kevin Williams on the reverse. Brock Marion. Marion brought down at the 38-yard line with 8 seconds left in the half. Lethem Flowers makes
Yet another special teams tackle for Pittsburgh.
Well, that's a good call by the Cowboys right there. Now what they can do with one big completion down the field, if they can get a timeout called quick enough, they would have a chance at a long field goal.
It's you're on the Dallas sidelines. The way they played this happened to be ahead by only 6 points. Somewhat puzzling.
Well, they had some opportunities. They're going to kneel down here. Just get out of here. That's smart.
So the final play of the half, and the Steelers give their fans a chance to cheer and the opportunity to hope.
Pittsburgh Steelers fans and all the advertisers who've been paying $1.2 million for 30 seconds advertising breaks are heaving a huge sigh of relief because Pittsburgh are back in the game at 13-7. We've got a Super Bowl on our hands. We'll be back after the break to look at the first half.
Into.
But whatever you do, don't say we didn't warn you. Roll the dice and unleash the adventure. Robin Williams. Jumanji, it's a jungle in there.
And so, gentlemen, despite the team's recent unlucky run, the chairman and the board of directors have assured me, quite categorically and without a shadow of a doubt, that they are 110% behind me and that I have their total support.
Hello, Ron. You better ring the Royal.
Well, I've not been very well, you know.
For all types of insurance, for all kinds of mishaps, you better ring the Royal.
You wouldn't help criminals, would you? Yet without neighborhood watch or street watch in your area, you could be making their lives easier. By giving as little as 2 hours a month, you could join the 6 million households already in these schemes and help to cut crime in your street. For a booklet telling you how, call 0345 235 235.
You'd turn into a handsome sheep shearer.
Oh, yeah!
Castle mine is made with golden clusters.
You haven't got a sister, have you?
Experienced hoppers wouldn't give a castle mine borax for any other lager.
Welcome back to Sun Devil Stadium. We've got a game on our hands, as I said, 13-7 at halftime to the Dallas Cowboys. The Steelers getting right back into it just before halftime with that six-yard touchdown pass from Neil O'Donnell to Yancey Thigpen. But let's go back, because the momentum for most of the game has been with the Cowboys, Drew, and it started early on with that huge completion from Troy Aikman to Deion Sanders.
Yeah, I think what this completion does is two things. Number one, it shows the Steelers that they're going to go to Deion, not just use him as a decoy. And number two, it's going to show the Steelers defense as well that they're going to open up their passing game and not just use Emmitt Smith on running plays. It was a great catch by Deion. It was a man-to-man situation, athlete versus athlete, and Deion won out in that situation.
But although he won out, all they got out of it was a field goal. And for all their domination in the first half, two field goals and one touchdown.
That's why we like when you get inside that 20-yard line area, the plus territory, you want touchdowns instead of field goals, because they got the touchdown with Novacek, and that gave them a nice lead. But now Steelers come back. They score a touchdown inside the 20, and we got a close ball game because the Cowboys get back down there and have to kick two field goals.
Now, Marv, the Steelers had put together one drive before halftime, 13 plays, got nothing out of it, and it looked like they were going to get nothing out of this one. They faced a third and long, but they got some help from the officials.
I think they did. From what I could see up here, my vantage point, they had a third down and long. They went to Ernie Mills. Mills caught it, what I felt was short of the first down mark right here. He had to cross the line. They throw him to the ground, but when they spotted the ball, they said first down. Steelers had a break like that in the Indianapolis game, and they had a break like that in our playoff game where
that's right. It was Mills again catching a pass and didn't get his feet down in the end zone.
That's correct, in both games.
But no doubt about it, they faced third down again later in the drive, and this time Mills converted well.
He certainly did. Further along in the drive on a third and 14, he double caught the ball, but he did make the catch, setting up with just a few seconds left in the half. The touchdown pass on a play or two later to Yancey's Thigpen, and they're right back in the game despite the fact that they appeared to be sputtering early and that Dallas had command of the game. Here it is, 13-7, and a big emotional lift for the Steelers as they go to the locker room.
And Ernie Mills, no time to be doing your Lynn Swann impression in a Super Bowl, is it true? But that got them down there, and on the very next play, first down and six, Neil O'Donnell looked at the end zone.
Yeah, well, it's on Deion Sanders, and Thigpen man-to-man with Sanders. I think Sanders might have been expecting some inside help, but it looks like he has a man-to-man. He takes an inside release on the play. Thigpen makes a great catch, great concentration as he's falling down into the end zone for the touchdown.
Deion seemed to be remonstrating with someone. I don't know whether it was himself. Were you surprised he didn't make a play on the ball? He seemed to be pushing him, handing him off to somebody.
Well, what I was surprised on in that situation was that he was backed off in his coverage and not playing a dog or man-to-man type defense at the line of scrimmage. Deion plays that better than anybody in the NFL. Why give the receiver that room to run a pass pattern? Go up and dog him, bump him around a little, disrupt the timing between the receiver and the quarterback.
All right, big momentum change, Marv. What do you think's being said in the respective locker rooms now?
Well, right now we've got a half to play no matter what it is. You know, the old coaching saw at halftime, the score is nothing and nothing. We just got to go out and play. Pittsburgh certainly has the emotional lift. Dallas is being told, look, we're champions. We've been through this before. We know how to handle it. Let's come back and put it to them and grind it out. And we can take charge of the game again.
All right. Well, we can't go down, unfortunately, into the locker rooms to eavesdrop, but we did get a chance to eavesdrop on Marv himself earlier in the season. Here's the results of it.
Hey, guys, where else would you rather be? Where else would you rather be? Okay. Hurry up. Hurry up. Get him out of the game. Hey, throw that jerk out. He's out of the ball game.
Damn it. Fumble. Let's.
Hey, Scott! Hey, Scott! Damn it, Scott! Scott Green!
That won't do any good.
Hey, Scott, that's a chicken call! Scott, that is a chicken call! That's a chicken call, Scott! Hey, Scott, come on, that's a chicken call!
Who? He's an idiot, the guy. He keeps doing it all the time. Thank you, fellas. Thank you.
And that was your 100th win as a Buffalo Bills coach. Do you forget that you're wired up on the sideline sometimes?
I'm not always that calm, Gary, on the side. Yes, I did forget I was wired up.
You got a kick out of that.
Yeah, I did. Well, Marv's the type of coach that I would love to play for, because you see on the sideline, he's very much into the game, doing everything he can from the sideline to help that team, help his team win the football game.
All right, well, I'm not sure it'll be quite as entertaining as Marv being wired up, but we're going to join the halftime show now. Diana Ross, Miss Ross to you, is singing.
Fall in love. Why do birds sing so gay? And I'm spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong, and I grew strong. I learned how to get along. Woo! I saw you back from out of space. I just walked in to find you here with that look upon your face. The change that stupid lock should have made you leave the key. If I had known for just 1 second, you'd be back to bother me. So now go, walk out the door. Just turn around now, 'cause you're not welcome.
Over the top, literally over the top of Sun Devil Stadium. We're joined by several guests now, all of them Rory Bremner. Rory, what did you make of that?
Well, they might have made an effort. I mean, really. It's nice to change them back home. You get Jerry Marsden and an orange. That's it, Trevor Brooking. But I think it's all a bit much, quite frankly. What worries is the person in front of me is wearing the same dress as Diana Ross. She's really annoyed about it.
Oh, really? Oh, no. All right, we'll be back with more Rory after this, if we can hear ourselves throw to the break. Here it comes.
Dear Volkswagen, I have recently purchased a Golf GTI. It costs less than $14,500 all in. As I appear to be the only person in the close to own one, everyone was keen to know how much it cost. So I said $16,500. Well, everyone thinks Volkswagens are expensive, don't they? Imagine my horror when I opened my newspaper to be confronted by the real price of a GTI. I think you could stop running adverts like this, as they're ruining my image. I've done what I can to stop people finding out, and so far I think I've got away with it. Yours faithfully, James Archer.
You put sugar in it.
If you're not happy, ring our customer complaints line.
It's a customer care line, Tony.
Since we got it, we've had nothing but complaints. Bourbon.
That's the point of it, Tony. So that we can find out if and when we're going wrong.
Aye. The more you keep them happy, the more they keep reordering.
Talk about reordering, Tom. How about you get me another cup of coffee without the sugar?
BT. To find out how to work smarter, not just harder, talk to us now on free phone 0800 800 800.
You're liking here. We're one big happy family, aren't we, Debs?
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's your photocopier. Poison. Departure lounge.
sorry?
Yeah, people tend not to last long in here. Heart attacks, ulcers, stress, non-stop pressure from Mr. Richard... Ah, Mr. Richardson.
Ah, Jane, suit you?
Hmm?
Your new office.
There may be trouble ahead, but while there's moonlight and music and love and romance, let's face the music and dance.
Because your job can change your life critically, Allied Dunbar Financial Plans adapt to help you face the unexpected.
Let's face the music and dance.
Problem?
Got it covered.
Allied Dunbar, for the life you don't yet know.
That's losing its head, a lager that doesn't.
Welcome back. It's 13-7 on the field, but we're up in the booth. They're still clearing away Diana Ross's stage. Rory, enjoying the game?
Oh yeah, this is something else, isn't it? Actually, I came up here to get away from doing the card stunt because I found the rules of that so incredibly complicated as in the game itself. The guy in front of me keeps on standing up. I keep wanting to get him to sit down, but there's one problem. The guy in front of me is Evander Holyfield.
Uh-huh.
Are you going to go and tell him to sit down? I don't think I am.
So.
And I'm gradually picking up the rules because I was a stranger to this when I came along. I'm still working out. I'm not sure the difference between a wide receiver and a tight end.
Well,
it's all very sexual, actually, Gary.
We'll fill you in during the break. What about the atmosphere?
There's a thought, isn't it? I could be filled in by Gary during the break. Don't miss that.
We'll be cutting away for that. We won't be staying here. But you were out taking part in another great American institution beforehand, tailgating.
Oh, yes, the tailgate. There's an incredible party going on. And there's, I mean, this is the game is incidental to this evening. It's totally. It's like a Diana Ross. It could have been anybody singing because it's all
that. People be switching off.
No. But it is. But the party itself is amazing. One of the Channel 4 executives spent half an hour queuing for a hamburger, only to discover when he got there that it was a queue for a massage. So he should have asked, can I have ketchup on mine, please? He got to the top, they said, would you like oil or talcum powder? No, just mayonnaise, it's fine. But I mean, the whole thing is just built around this game. It's extraordinary, it's only in America, but I mean, if this is an ice cream, this would be like quintuple ice chocolate with chocolate chip, more chocolate and chocolate. You just don't know when enough is enough. But it is an extraordinary, I think you need to see this once in your life. It's an I mean, everybody, let me just tell you, Gary, everybody who is anybody in the world of sport is here tonight. So hi to Steve Ryder back in London, if you're watching. I miss Motti. I think Motti make a lot of this, actually.
Motti. What do you think he'd make of this, Motti?
Well, I think it's quite extraordinary, because that gown that Diana Ross was wearing was, in fact, 350 yards of liquid gold. The only time I ever saw that was Judith Chalmers during an early edition of Wish You Were Here, when she wore a similar thing and did a similar stunt. But what about these players?
Oh, well, I'm going to have to cut you off for impersonating a commentator on a rival station. Now, Rory's not the only Brit over here. We've got four competition winners. Here they are.
Hello, this is Robert Alain here, and we're at the Super Bowl in Phoenix. This is Angela Alain, this is Mrs. Whitaker, and Mr. Whitaker. Now, who are you rooting for?
I'll root for Pittsburgh.
All right. Well, who are you rooting for?
Dallas Cowboys.
And who are you rooting for?
Definitely the Cowboys.
That means we're about 75% Cowboys here. And we're having a lovely time in Phoenix, and I'd just like to say hello to everybody that goes to St. Andrew's Church in Harrow and everyone that goes to Rooks Deep High School. And I predict that Dallas will win by 21 points.
He's impersonating John Motson's. Kids trying to take my job in the stands, but...
It's amazing. Everything is so organized in America, even down to the result. You can say, well, who's going to win the Super Bowl this year? Well, it's going to be Dallas Cowboys, but it could be quite a good game. But because they don't like unpredictability. And mind you, that last touchdown's made it really interesting.
It has made it interesting. Are you actually getting into the swing of things between wide receivers and tight ends? Have you picked up any players?
Well, Cordell Stewart. He's one of these new guys. He's quite young. He starts off in one position and ends up in a completely different. He's the sort of Tony Blair of the side, isn't he? But his nickname is Slash, incidentally, isn't it? I thought that was O.J. Simpson's nickname, but because O.J. was so good, they were saying he was the most valued player, O.J. In fact, he's so good nobody could lay a glove on him. It's terrific.
All right.
You're a good lawyer.
And on that note, we'll hand you back to the second half.
Oh, is there a game happening?
Chris Boniol's going to kick it off.
Oh, there's a game as well.
With Rory's permission. And the Steelers, 13-7 down, but with the momentum, are going to receive and have the first possession of the third quarter.
Come on, you whites.
Game and a wobbler toward the sidelines goes out of bounds. There's a big break for the Steelers. They're going to get the ball at the 40-yard line.
Huge mistake on special teams. And you know, all they ask you to do is kick the ball down the field. All day long, they've been trying to kick the ball to the left-hand side, and they've been doing that very well. But when you do that, Dick, if you slip at all, the ball goes out of bounds because you're flirting with the sideline. This puts the ball on the 40-yard line.
Let's compare the starting quarterbacks. Troy Aikman, only four hit the ground, one a touchdown pass. Neil O'Donnell, 9 for 17, warmed up in the second quarter, and he too with a touchdown throw, both from inside the 10-yard line. Great field position for Pittsburgh at the 40. Van Horst trying to go inside, and Tony Tolbert grabs him by the nape of the neck and waits for help, and Robert Jones is there to support. No game.
Well, Tony Tolbert just destroys this play. Gets up the field and just ruins all the blocking the Pittsburgh Steelers have. Right here, you see him get up the field. Now, John L. Williams has to try to block him instead of going down the field and opening the hole up for Eric Pegram. Or for Van Morris, I'm sorry.
There's Tony Tolbert. Said, boy, he watched Reggie White, the great Green Bay Packer, go off the field after losing 2 weeks ago, and he said, now I know how important this game is. Dumps it off to Van Morris, who catches field passes, and he gets in the open field. He's a bowling ball to the 50-yard line.
This is something the Steelers haven't done today. Throw the ball to the back when you send everybody down the field. This time the wide receivers and tight ends go down. They clear it out. Neil O'Donnell, excellent job. Drop it off to Van Morris. Really, the only person that has a chance to make the tackle quickly is Robert Jones.
And I guarantee you, that was not by design. Bam almost dropped the ball, but he picked up the first down.
Caught only 8 passes all year. First down at the 50. That's the first completion to someone other than a wide receiver. Morris, big hole. Look at him run over tackles. Still on his feet to the 35. Oh, my.
This whole thing starts with a good block by John L. Williams.
So watch John L. Williams come to your left here. You're just going to see him coming right there. Look at this.
Boom.
Dixon Edwards just put. Darren Smith, he just knocks right out of the hole. And Van Morris, a big man with good feet. Defensive back, do not want to see him get in the secondary.
Darren Woodson going to the Pro Bowl again. Finally made the shirt tail tackle. That's a load. For Morris, a 10-yard reception and a 15-yard run. And this time up the middle and not much there. Russell Maryland, the first player picked in the draft of 1991.
Dick, I'm not picking on Dion. You know, he missed the tackle earlier in the game. But we asked Bam, we said, you know, if you get a shot at running to the outside, you know, Dion's coming up. You afraid of him?
He'll
tackle me. He's going to get out of the way.
That's right. He said he won't even try.
He said he'll step aside and run me down and try to force me out of bounds, but he's not going to step up.
Let him run by and then grab him from behind.
That's it.
Second down and 9. Ooh, Mark Bruner wasn't looking for the pass.